You know, sometimes the week after Easter or Christmas can kind of seem like a letdown a little bit. We're worshiping in our normal pattern again. Some of the pomp and the circumstances are a little bit less. But today we're reminded in our lessons that Easter is not really over. The joy of Easter continues on even today. Today we're going to see how Easter changed everything. It had an effect upon the early disciples, and it continues to change you and me even to this day. Our opening hymn is hymn 145, the great Easter hymn, "Jesus Lives, the Victory's Won." The men's choir is going to sing stanzas 1 through 3, and then we ask you to join us in singing stanzas 4 and 5, the last two stanzas of hymn 145, "Jesus Lives, the Victory's Won." May God bless you.
Jesus lives, I know.
continue on page 26 in our hymnal. We'll give you the service of word and sacrament. Page 26, please stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us.
Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
For all that we need in life and for the wisdom to use all your gifts with gratitude and joy, hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayer, O Christ. For the well-being of your holy church in all the world, and for those who offer here their worship and praise, hear our prayer, O Lord. Merciful God, make your end preserver of life, uphold us by your power, and keep us in your tender care.
Today in the sermon,
I'm going to be talking about Peter and John, two of Jesus' disciples. And Peter and John, one day, they were going to the temple. They were going there to pray. They might have done that too, I don't know. They were going to the temple to pray and to worship Jesus when, well, I didn't think that happened. And then they went to the church, and they saw a man there who wasn't able to walk. He was crippled. His legs didn't work. And this man was begging for money because he had no way of making money. He had no way of getting a job. Peter and John, though, they weren't very rich. But they said to him, "We don't have money." He said, "I don't have any money to give to you. But one thing I am going to do for you." He said, "In the name of Jesus, get up and walk." And all of a sudden, this man, who was not able to walk from when he was just a baby, got up and started walking and running around and praising God. And everyone saw this. And they were just mystified. They were amazed. How could Peter and John, these two guys, heal someone? Peter tells them, it wasn't because of us that this man was healed. It was because of Jesus. Jesus, who they crucified, was back from the dead. He was alive. And he had given Peter and John the power to do these miracles. Jesus is still healing people today. Maybe not like the way this man was healed, who was crippled and couldn't walk. But Jesus still heals you and me. How does Jesus heal us? What does he heal us from? He watches over us when we're sick, right? Sometimes he does intervene and helps us with that. But what did we need to get healed from? Our biggest problem and disease in life? Sin. Jesus healed us from sin when he died on the cross and took the punishment for sin so that you and I wouldn't have to have that punishment. And we know that Jesus didn't stay dead, but he rose from the dead. And that's what we celebrated last week, Sunday, on Easter. That we serve and worship a God who is alive and who is watching over us. We worship Jesus. Yes. Jesus. We use Jesus' name a lot in worship, don't we? In church and Bible study and Sunday school. We talk about Jesus all the time. Yeah, he does. Jesus watches over us all the time, and he forgives us all the time as well. What I brought for you, and when we go on field trips, Jesus watches over us. I brought with me today, for each one of you, the name of Jesus in a whole bunch of different languages from all over the world. These are all different ways of saying Jesus. I'm going to give each one of you one of these coloring sheets here. And you can color this during the service or afterwards sometime. And what I want you to do during the church service, I want you to kind of pay attention. And I want you to see if you can figure out how many times I say the name Jesus during the church service. Before we leave the altar today, let's bow our heads and let's pray to Jesus. Dear Jesus, thank you for healing us from our sin when you died on the cross and when you rose from the dead. Help us to worship you every day of our lives, especially when we're here at church. Help us to sing hymns of praise. Help us to pray to you and help us to listen to you and to you alone. Amen. Thanks for coming up. You can go back to your seats. Our first lesson for today is from Acts chapter 3, verses 12 through 20. This picks up right after what I was talking with the kids about, right after Peter and John healed this man. God gives Peter preach about Jesus. When Peter saw this, he addressed the people. Men of Israel, why are you amazed at this? Why are you staring at us as if by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant, whom you handed over and disowned in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. You disowned the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you. You killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. We are witnesses of this. And on the basis of faith in his name, it is the name of Jesus that has strengthened this man, whom you see and know. This faith that comes through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. Now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, just like your leaders. But in this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Therefore, repent and return to have your sins wiped out, so that refreshing times may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus the Christ appointed for you. This is the word of our God. Let's now join in singing the song of the day, Psalm 16, which is on page 68 in front of our Bibles.
This is how we know that we love the children of God,
when we love God and keep His commands. In fact, this is love for God, that we keep His commands. And His commands are not burdensome, because everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is the one who overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by the water alone, but by the water and by the blood. The Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is truth. This is God's holy word. The verse of the day. Alleluia, alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Alleluia.
Thank you.
Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The words that we are meditating upon for this morning are our first lesson from Acts chapter 3, verses 12 through 20. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Dear brothers and sisters, I have a confession to make. I'm a little tired. I'm a little worn out today. Maybe you are too. The past couple of weeks, you go through this emotional coaster ride. 2 Sundays ago, we marched into Jerusalem for the last time with Jesus. We watched as he rode that colt, the pole, and the donkey, while the adoring crowds waved their palm branches and threw their coats onto the road, all while singing out, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest." Really, we heard how Jesus was making front page news. Unfortunately, that good story took a turn for the worse. We heard how Jesus was arrested, put into a sham of a trial, how he was convicted. We saw how people hit him, spit on him, placed a crown of thorns on him. We heard how he was brought before the Roman governor, and how instead of pleading for this man's life, he kept silent. We saw the crowds change from shouting Hosanna to shouting Crucify, Crucify. And then we looked as we saw Jesus forsaken by his own Father in heaven as he hung on the cross bearing the full weight of the sins of the world. We heard him shout his announcement that the work of salvation was finished. And just a week ago, we were right there with the women who got up early that first Easter morning to give Jesus a proper burial, how they went out to the tomb and they found it empty, how 2 angels said, "He's not here, he's risen." We were there with Mary as she turns around and she sees the risen Lord. It was all absolutely true. Jesus has risen from the dead. And now we're here a week later. So what happens now? Is Easter over and done with, the decorations put away? The answer is no. It's important that you and I understand that Easter didn't end with last Sunday. It keeps going. And for the next several weeks, our scripture lessons are going to look at what happened after Easter. Our text is part of the sermon the Apostle Peter gave at least 2 months or so after Jesus rose from the grave on Easter. And yet his message focuses on the events of Holy Week. In fact, really, that's what Peter and the rest of the disciples would be talking about for the rest of their lives. They would continue to proclaim how Jesus died and how he rose. Peter spoke these words following quite an amazing miracle. One day, Peter and John made their way to the temple to pray. They happened to walk past a man who had been crippled from birth. The man begged for money. Peter and John turned to this man and said, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give you in the name of Jesus Christ. Walk." And instantly the man got up, started walking around. Now, since this man was known to many, a crowd began to gather when they saw this guy who they know was crippled running around and praising God. And the crowd concluded that, well, Peter and John must have been responsible for this man's good fortune. Peter makes it clear that the power to heal this man didn't come from himself or from John. And so that there wouldn't be any doubt about it, he says to them, "And on the basis of faith in his name, it is the name of Jesus that has strengthened this man whom you see and know. This faith that comes through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you." This man was not really healed by Peter or John. He was healed by Jesus. Apparently, that news came as a bit of a shock to those gathered around Peter, because he then goes on to say, "Men of Israel, why are you amazed at this? Why are you staring at us as if by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus." Jesus, Peter says. Do you remember him? Well, who could forget the events that had taken place not that long ago? And in case they had forgotten, Peter reminds them who Jesus is. "You handed him over and disowned him in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. You disowned the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you. You killed the author of life." Wow. What a soul penetrating preaching of the law. In the Easter aftermath, Peter says, there is plenty of blame to go around. Speaking through Peter, the Holy Spirit was striving to crush the people's impenitent hearts. No longer would they be allowed to put their evil actions behind them and then console themselves by saying, "Well, we're pretty good religious people. We've been praying all these years. We're looking forward to the Messiah." Because the Messiah had come, and they put him to death. That truth hit them like a bolt of lightning. And it was all true. The people had handed Jesus over to be killed. Their hearts had become so hardened that they wouldn't even listen to the governor who wanted to let Jesus go. Even a pagan ruler knew Jesus was innocent. Instead, they shouted for a murderer to be released and for Jesus to be crucified. He couldn't escape Peter's words that day. And the crowd realized that they knew it. Peter's words hurt. They stung. But they were all true. We handed Jesus over. We imposed our will. We rejected the Christ. We mocked him. We spit him on him. We nailed him to the tree. We crucified him. We killed the author of life. The evidence against the crowd was pretty damning. Is there evidence against us as well? It's easy to point up our fingers at the crowd and say, "Look at what they did." But if we're honest, and if you look at our own hearts, we're not any better. You and I are sinful human beings. Every time we sin, every time you take the Lord's name in vain, or break one of his commandments, or every time you ignore the means of grace, it's as if I'm part of that crowd, standing at the foot of the cross, mocking you, jeering at him, spitting on him. It was my sins. It was your sins that put Jesus on the cross. It was my sin that shouted out, "Crucified, he crucified." Those are facts. Can't dispute it. Peter's preaching to you and me. Like the crowd that gathered before Peter and John, us, our crowd here, we too need to hear the preaching of the law, because there's plenty of money to go our way too. We too need to recognize what we've done. You and I are sinners. We desperately need a Savior. But that's what makes Easter so amazing. And that's why we celebrate Easter every single Sunday, which is just a mini Easter, an anniversary of Easter. It's in this Easter aftermath that, yes, there's a lot of blame to go around. The preaching of the law must be preached. But thanks be to God, because there's a lot more grace to be given as well. During the past several weeks, we've focused on what Jesus did for us. How he endured life in a sinful world. How he endured the cross of the grave. We No one believed that Jesus died for the sins of the entire world, which includes you and me. And the great part is, Jesus didn't stay dead, but came back to life. Peter told the crowd, God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. Peter and the other disciples were firsthand witnesses of the resurrected Christ. Peter and John saw the empty tomb. Jesus appeared to Peter. He appeared to the women at the grave, to the two disciples on the way to Emmaus. And over the next several days, he appeared to more than 500 people. Jesus Christ is not dead, but alive. So now Peter explains that all the power to effect a complete healing of this crippled man lay in Jesus' name. It wasn't really Peter or John who healed him, but it was the living Lord who did this, who has this power. This miracle further proved that Jesus is alive and he is active in his grace and his power. And what's even more important than the fact that this man was healed is why he was healed. This crippled man was healed that day so that the people could see, so that they could ask, so that they could hear the preaching of the law and be cut in their own hearts, and then so they might hear and believe the gospel and be brought to faith through this good news. By the grace of God and by the power of the Holy Spirit, our hearts are cut by the law of God. We know we are sinners. We know we need a Savior. We've also been led to hear and to believe the comfort of the gospel. We know and believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. He is the Savior of the world. Peter now turns his attention back to the deeds of the crowd. He says to them, "Now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, just like your leaders. The descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob should have known who the Messiah was and what he was going to do and how he was going to act and what he was going to look like. The Old Testament prophets said that the Messiah was going to suffer at the hands of evil men, that he was going to be put to death, that he was going to rise from the dead. They should have recognized that. But they didn't. Because they envisioned a different kind of Messiah, a Messiah that conformed to their own thinking, a Messiah that they wanted, a Messiah that would rescue them from the Romans and restore the glory to the house of Israel, instead of a Messiah who would forgive sins and provide the way to eternal life. The people that day were ignorant, but they were not innocent. They had sinned. They had put the author of life to death. So Peter calls on them to repent, and then he points out that even though their actions were evil and sinful, God, in his wisdom and his love, used them for his own good purposes. Now, that was all part of God the Father's plan from the very beginning. The plan was simple. Since God demands perfection, and we're not perfect, he sent his Son to live the perfect life in our place as our substitute. Jesus Christ came into the world, became human in every way, suffered at the hands of sinful men, and then willingly gave up his life in place of our only thing. He suffered the punishment meant for us so that you and I wouldn't have to suffer. And as a result of what Jesus did, our sins are now gone. They are paid in full. It is finished, Jesus cried out. And the benefit of this tremendous act of grace and love becomes our own by grace through faith alone. So that all those who believe in this risen Lord receive all of the blessings that God just wants to pour out on us. It's by the grace and the power of God, the Holy Spirit, that we see our sin, we see our Savior. We've been led to believe what Jesus has done for us. It's by the grace of God that faith has been created in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, working through the means of grace, through holy baptism, through the spoken word. Now, compelled by what Christ has done for us, we continually, day by day, repent of our sins and continue to go back to God for the forgiveness that we know we will find there. We continue to find comfort and joy not in a dead Savior, but in a living Savior and in an empty tomb. We continue to glorify the risen Lord through the way we live our lives, through our words, and through our actions, as our entire purpose in life is now to glorify and honor our living God. Easter changes everything. Easter continues to change everything. For Christ has risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Amen. The peace of God, which transcends understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please stand and let's confess our faith in our risen Lord as we use the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. As we gather our thank offering, I would ask that you also please sign our friendship registers, which are located at the end of each pew. Save you. word, and for your Son's body and blood, which you give us to eat and to drink the sacrament. Through these means of grace, you send the Holy Spirit into our hearts and unite us to Jesus and to the whole Christian church on earth.
Strengthen us through this heavenly food. Increase our trust in Christ and our love for one another.
Great God and Lord, without your continuing help, we easily waver in our faith and lose courage and grow careless in our watchfulness. The times and days are perilous. Give us strength to face the evils of each day with fresh confidence. Open our lips to speak of your grace and move us to use the gifts that you give us to share your word of salvation with all people. Protect and prosper the family, the school, the government, and all good institutions that you have established for the benefit of society. Remember in mercy those who are sick and suffering, and bring your healing to troubled homes and lives.
Move us to pray for those in need, and to help them with deeds of kindness.
Lord, we pray today for swift recovery for Carol Brunmeyer, Ann Ashbaugh, and King Griffin, who are recovering from surgery. Grant them peace of mind as they put their trust in the name of Jesus, who promises to be with them. If it is your will, O Father, grant them an ease of pain and renewed health. And hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. Now, eternal God and Father, keep us in the saving faith, and so enable us to overcome all things through our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we now join and pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Take and drink, this is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, poured out for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Now may this strengthen and preserve you in the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven.
This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Give us the gift of your sins.
Take and drink. This is the true love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Pour out for you.
Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
pledge of your forgiveness, may be restored to live a new and holy life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, share the gospel, and serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you peace. This coming Wednesday, we're going to start a new Bible study called Defenders and Defamers of the Faith. We're going to be looking at church history, the last 2,000 years. That's going to start at 7 o'clock Wednesday right here in the Narthex, or in the sanctuary, I'd say. And finally, Pastor Berger and I are going to be gone Tuesday and then most of Wednesday at a pastor's conference, which is out of town. So if you need to get a hold of us, give Amy a call at the church here, and she'll be able to track us down somewhere. That's all the announcements I have.